Hey, ma'am.
Good evening.
Good evening, everyone. Yes.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening. Good evening.
Good evening, Sri.
Yes, good evening. So, good evening to all of you, and welcome to this Ask Satan series where we're going to talk about the value conscious parenting, right? And let's see what we have in store for you and what kind of questions you have for us so that we are able to answer that, right? So, sir, would you like to start?
Okay, so let me begin with, please all of you mute and let me create a background for you to ask questions, and then we'll take up questions. Now, when we talk about value-conscious parenting, I believe that the biggest inspiration or insight come from this quote. Is really touched us, that your child has come through you, but not from you. So you are a channel and a conduit, in fact. And they are, of course, with you. They belong not to you. It may be a shock, maybe to some of the parents, but that's the truth. So all that you can do is you can give them your love and not your thoughts. But you all end up in giving your thought, your process. So, because they are their own thoughts, they are their own complete system, a very intelligent system brought into this world. And when we talk about that value conscious parenting, then first you must know is how to differentiate between the liking, what is of liking and what is of value. So when you look at your kids and children of any age, most often you understand what are they liking. So for example, when you go out, you buy stuff that they like, whether that is of value or not. If I put a question to you in your mind right now, that if you're buying thing for your kids, what do you think? This is what my kid likes. And that is where, even as children, you end up buying things they like to eat. And they may be wafers, potato chips, finger fries, or what you call French fries, and all that stuff. So when you ask this question to people several times, when we interact or when I interact with them, I often ask them that, if you have to buy something or get something for your child, what would you do? And they will say, this is what my child likes. Though sometimes they do say, this is what my child loves, but they end up buying things what my child will like. So for a value conscious parenting, you must differentiate between what is of liking and what is of value. Until you start differentiating, you cannot inculcate values in them. You cannot bring up based on values. So this requires you must engage your child in valuing what's really valuable. But most often we get sold not by their love, but by their emotions. And I've seen mothers, you know, so in one of the workshop, some mother was sharing her experience with Siri, that my kid, you know, it's too much. He's 18 now nearly, and he doesn't like food at home. I have to every day, you know, order something from Domino's, Pizza Hut, MacD, or some other restaurant. Then she asked a question, that what do you think that? Where has it come from? And she kept holding that lady in this space of, you know, searching within, that she was in fact complaining or she was talking about. And soon that said, Siri, I think you're quite right. You know, right from the infancy days and, you know, childhood time, then I often had been telling them, okay, you want to eat this? Okay, not eat. You want to eat this? Okay, not this. You want to eat this? So in fact, it is we only condition children, not this, not this, not this. Okay, this, right? And in that process, just to take off our own burden that they shouldn't trouble us or we shouldn't take more time, and because you do not know how to really engage them, either you force them or you end up giving them something that is what they like to eat, maybe they like to wear. So point to keep a watch here is the way you give one after the another offer. Is it really of value, or is it coming from because you don't have time and you are giving them what they like? And let me come to the next point, that what does not let the values to inculcate in children is that sometime and many times rather, both the parents are, you know, two different faces. They have to be, you know, both cannot be same. So, but most parents confront rather than stay united while in front of children. Now, it is like, you know, one of the parents become kind of a, metaphorically speaking, the character in the monkey and the two cats story, and they try to pacify. And in that pacification, in fact, they rob both of something to in fact turn out more smarter and to be more likable. And that's what does not let, in fact, enable people to have value conscious parenting. So they soon lose the consciousness about values. So you are not to be the parent who's continuously trying to give equal pies to the child and the other parent. And that's another input I want to give you before you start asking this question, that, and that's what in fact the value conscious parenting is, that you must know that both the spouses cannot be ever, ever, ever same. They have to be different. They have to be very unique. They have to be of their own set of values. However, that should not lead to confrontation, and especially in front of children. So the difference has to be sorted behind, and it has not to be emotional support. And sometimes, you know, they support each other, but that looks very artificial, as if one is, you know, agreeing to kind of things, but inside is a disagreement. So the another factor that help to bring children with values or in value conscious parenting is that being united and having a united front, and not rather than confront with each other. Let me come to the third thing, the another thing, I don't know, two or three, that appreciate child as an individual. So this requires you to know the difference between influencing and inspiration. Because child is of his own mind, of her own mind, and child has own set of thinking and thoughts. But most parents think that is as if they are the extension of my dreams, my hopes, my unmet desires. Not to offend or attack anyone, but I have seen sometime children, you know, the parents are told by some age regression therapist or some called modern consultant of spirituality that, you know, whatever you cannot do, in fact, children are your unmet desires. So they start imposing upon things what they have in mind, and they think that, I think whatever I could not do because I could not become a doctor, I could not become a chartered accountant because I could not become an artist, so let my child, or my child is an extension of mine. Now, if you are of that kind, you are not doing the value conscious parenting. So if you are thinking that they are the extension of your dreams, chances are you will remain always in tension and you will slip and drift from you know, bringing children based on the value conscious parenting. Because value conscious parenting is about, you know, bringing values and inculcating values in people and children especially, who are totally in your hand until quite a mature age. And if that's the time you built up and you bring some values in them, definitely it will bring values back to you. It will pay you back. You will find more of appreciation. Your own value will increase. Another point about value conscious parenting is that helping them to understand the potential or potentiality and the identity. Now, this requires parents to understand that every child is born with certain tendencies. Now, Indian science specifically talks about it, that how we are born with some samskaras and pravartis, okay, and those tendencies and the natural bents are there. However, when parents don't have capability and they don't have an eye to detect that, how those tendencies can be in fact turned into some creation, some evolution of who the person is, then they end up, you know, buying things from here. That means buying ideas from other people, buying ideas from the world, thinking that I'm the most mature person, most experienced person, and they ignore totally the tendencies the child is born with and the natural bent the child has. Child may have a bent in dancing, may have bent in artistry, may have bent in painting, may have bent in singing, may have bent in, you know, engineering, maybe mechanical, maybe, you know, fixing things. So most parents, quite a number of time, fail to recognize those tendencies and how that tendencies are coming from the potential within, and that natural bent can be in fact harnessed, and a true identity can be evolved. And the another point here is that turning those tendencies with human values, and how can you humanize them? So tendencies plus a natural bent plus humanity and supporting it is value conscious parenting. Now, when I'm speaking all these points, this gives you a chance that when you do it, when you don't do it, what are the difficulties you find, and how can you in fact succeed in value conscious parenting? So the next point, that most parents, in the name of care, they in fact bring a lot of scare. So they don't differentiate the difference between caring and scaring. Their own fears, their own limitations, their own boundaries are what they impose upon. And though if a child is allowed, or children are allowed to, you know, be in themselves and be in their own human beingness, you know that the cagey try to influence Bharat so much, of jealousy, of greed for throne, of greed of kingdom, but she failed. So until you really do tricks, it's very difficult to influence children on their own, because their potential and their humanity with which they are born, until you start tampering with it and you start fingering with it or fiddling with it, or you start engineering with it, the child will find the own expression of whom being they are. And in fact, they are not born. No human being is born to harm anyone. Until you bring and impose your fears and scares on them, that's where their internal defense system, you know, that become very strong. And they tend to, you know, become victim of the greed and the ego. So the before the ego touch, in fact, the fear touch, and to overcome the fears, what they resort to is the ego. So as a parent, the another point here to, you know, succeed in value conscious parenting is that differentiate between the scare and care, and in the name of care, do not scare them. Now, not much I have to say. And the last or one more point I will mention is that there's nothing like a perfect child. So there's nothing like an ideal child that most parents start looking into. You have to simply learn to deal with the uniqueness the child born with, and understand that as a beauty. And as I always keep telling, that diversity of existence is beauty. So not looking as or imposing on child. Now, most parents do say it, yes, you know, I know my child is unique, but they still end up, you know, buying fear or capturing fears or capturing influences or capturing those who are succeeding in some or the other way, and imprinting their own mind with photodynamics of all that is happening in the world and creating a movie of that and thrusting upon children. And they in fact curb the entire uniqueness. And uniqueness is the beauty. So when you look the child as a perfect child, and that too you mix with something like your own influences and the movie that you see around the world, and that's where the entire thing goes. And most parents feel that time in value conscious parenting, that's where the values are hardly left, and what left is only the showmanship. So that's all I think I have to say here, that these are some of the vital points that most parents can keep in mind. And that speaks the volume of things, if it must have triggered him. So let me now begin with taking questions, and me and Siri will answer your question, that where do you do it, where you don't do it, and what comes on your way, and what can be done there. So we are the collective minds here, and to find the avenues with our own experience that we have come across. And Siri has been really, really many time helping children and the parents. I think we'll be of much use to you. So
please raise your hands. You have an option of raising the hands.
And let's select the question. And we'll select the question that who's to ask question.
Sir. Okay. And, so what we'll do is we'll ask them to raise the hand on the screen, and you can do a thumbs up, or if you're on the video, then we can ask you one by one.
Best will be to just raise your hand or something on Zoom itself. Okay. So we can see at the same time how many hands are raised, because video is not visible for everyone. So please raise your hand on Zoom app.
Okay. In the meanwhile, we have Satnam. Yes. So since we can see him, Satnam, you can ask your question.
Yeah, please unmute.
Satnam, please unmute yourself.
Yeah, I have not heard anything.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
I can hear you. Who's there?
Satnam.
Okay. Satnam, you always want to ask first question.
Okay. I can ask later now.
Go ahead right now.
All right. Okay.
Ask question like a question. That's my only request.
Okay.
Okay.
Sometimes when the children are maybe around 12, this is a time I've seen that problem occurring. It's a standard pattern wherein, under the guise of a caring parents, or that we want that child to do well, both the parents become control freaks. Mm-hmm. And the child starts rebelling as a consequence. And as I know, this is a couple of cases are coming up. As the exams are coming up, this is the 12th standard, at least in this my case. The child, in fact, has started responding more from his rebellious attitude, given up the studies, and parents are becoming more and more panicky and trying to put more and more restrictions and trying to do micromanagement of his studies. And when you speak to the parents, they said, we are doing the best. How can we just let him waste his life? This idea ki you have to get off his back, and the energy that he is using to push you all, guy, maintain his dignity and let go of a little bit of control he could utilize for studies, somehow a parent don't seem to understand that. You know, they're so, hyper. So what technique we could use? I've tried developmental thing, you know, what all people are children in a developmental stage, why he needs, they are unable to get over the hang up of he's still a child, unable to manage. Ye bada hota to apna pad leta, ye bada hota to ye karta. So they have a long list of reasons why he's no more an adult, and I need to sort of, you know, control his every movement. So basically, how should we make parents understand to let go of their, this puppet strings, so that child could have a little bit of freedom?
You are asking about the other parents, or like your own?
No, not mine. But as a general pattern, this I've seen the pattern repeating. So,
what should be question, Satnam?
The question is, what strategies you should use to let the parent get off the back of the child?
Okay. Right. All right. So the biggest strategy, you know, it's a fearing comes from fearing. That means fearing others come from our own fears. So the only strategy has to be that how do we help parents to identify their own fears. And
okay,
that's the simple strategy. So let Siri add further.
It's also about, you know, how we have been brought up, Satnam. Because we have been always told that if you will not study, you will not get a good job, you will not get married, you will not do this, how will you run your life, what will happen to you? So what sir said is absolutely right. It comes from fear. So as a part of strategy, it's about helping the parents to understand that, you know, if the child has been come to your family and if how much ever you can support them is your responsibility. And then you can tell the child to do whatever is useful as a part of the values, inculcating that if you do this, if you are helping them or if they are studying, it's a part of the general kind of the environment where we have grown up, then it's good. But I believe today, if you make parents aware, and parents are quite aware, it's not only about just studies. There are so many fields which are available today in the market where a child can really, really make a living out of it. Because that's the biggest fear what I have dealt with the parents. When it comes to studies, how will he study? How will he grow? What will he do his work? You know, how will he earn his living? So that's a basic fear which I have encountered with the parents. But if you, they really see out, you know, and if they really see there are so many fields available, probably you have to really awaken them to tell them that first understand what the child really wants and then help them to grow from there, whatever is required from them. So it's about right parenting, you know, how to really make them aware of the things what they are really want the child to do, also from that perspective.
Okay.
I hope this answers your question.
Yes. Another hands I find raised are some of the, first let me see some of the unconventional people. Quite the conventional people are there too, of course. Okay. I find Ajay Ramakrishnan. Okay, Ajay. Yes.
So good evening, everybody. Sir and Siri ji, thank you so much. Wonderful topic. And I just wanted to add on to what both of you all have said, because I'm dealing with children. I do a lot of career mentoring and I deal with parents at various levels. What both of you all have said are the essence, and I experience this regularly. And what Siri ji said about the vocation of the child, that causes that fear a parent has that ki mera beta bada hokar karega kya. That fear, if that fear gets addressed, I generally find that parents are quite comfortable with other things. I'll give you an example. A parent came to me with a child ki mera beta school mein sirf baatein karta rehta hai aur cricket khelta rehta hai aur kuch kaam hi nahi uska. So what we did was, we did a psychometric evaluation. We found that he's got a great ability to speak publicly and he had athletic interests. So we told the parent that because a child can speak, he can easily become a commentator. And since he's interested in cricket, that's a very viable option. He can become an MC. He can look after events. He can manage events. So what Siri ji said is very relevant. Today, I personally have a database of 22,000 career options. Parents on the whole, across India, there's been a study, cannot list more than 7 career options for the children. It is this insecurity which plays up in many ways.
Okay, good. I think you're adding input. So you have any question or you just wanted to add inputs?
I just wanted to add this input, sir.
Okay, yes, Anju, you had some, you have some question. You have written also in the chat box. Yes, Anju.
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Sir, the thing is that, sir, first of all, thank you so much for all these webinars. It's really informative and very appreciating and inspiring too at the same time. So as a coach, I do have parents coming in when two parents have opposite views for their child. So, sir, in this case, how can I as a coach help them to understand that the opposite views are their own individual views and could be not, neither one's views goes for the child. The child is something different. So how can we as a coach help such parents? More than, you know, saying ke, your child is this, your child is that, instead of guiding them or telling them to do things, how can as a coach I can help these parents?
Okay.
More than the child.
Okay, see, you have to say something first, then I'll add it later.
I think it's about, you know, first, Anju, it's about, since you said it's about how you can coach them, if you can individually help them to understand first that what is their value system, since you have understood the values part of it also, that what is the value that they are coming out with? What are their internal values? How do they see their child? And if you first kind of individually coach them to understand their vision separately, and then help them to create a common vision of what they really want the child to be. That's one aspect of it. But third and important aspect is then also ask the child what the child wants to do. Because it can really happen that the mother wants to do this and the father wants this and the child wants something separate. So all of the three, ask them their individual vision, ask them the values where they're coming from, and the most important about the child. And then find out and tell them, get back to them saying, okay, this is what the child wants. Now what do you have to really do about them? Instead of becoming really control freaks in different ways and, you know, expecting the child to do what they haven't been able to do in their life. So that's what you can do actually as a coach. So you can add.
Okay. So picking a clue of what Siri has given insight, I don't know how many of you really picked up. The main reason here is that, in fact, though we live by values and certain values do rule us, we have no idea about our own values. So when two parents are at conflict with each other and they are not able to bring the child based on the values, the main reason is both don't have an idea about their individual values. They have only idea of the differences they have with each other and the comparison they have with each other and the approach they have with each other differently, but they have no idea about that. What set of values I hold, what set of values my spouse hold, then take a clue what Siri has told, that creating a shared vision based on what? Based on what a child is in fact having the tendencies and having the bents and the mind bents, and beautifying and nurturing that, forgetting ourselves, but cultivating those things and humanizing those mind bends and tendencies, and then helping the child to elicit and have value clarification right from the early age. So often in our workshop, we tell people that parents are the most unfit people to raise children. And this is a very shocking statement, in fact, because they're so much entangled and involved emotionally, and the way they have difference with each other, they have no idea about that, how to in fact raise kids, inculcating certain values. And in the old system, in the old educational system in India, there were Montessoris, there were madrasas, and there were gurukuls, and the special person over there will groom the child of the tendencies and the mind bent the children had, and job was much easier. But nowadays they have more idea about the information spread around, but they have no idea about what do we value really, and what can we make our child value. So valuing the valuables part is missing. So the point straight and the answer to you, Anju, is that you do the value clarification exercise with each of the parent, and then help them to sort and align those values, and also understand the values of the kid, and become very clear about it, that if we are nurturing our kid, then which will be the values that we will be governed by to raise our kid, and how will we value that every single moment. So that's the whole assignment. So it is just not like one or two session, but that's like taking a full assignment with them. That's the answer.
Thank you so much.
So we have Sonali asking a question, that my son is going to be 18 years old, and this one, I'm missing it out. Okay. Yeah, and he keeps awake at night and sleeps during the day, eats at weird hours. How to approach him for this wrong lifestyle? Okay. So would you like to answer, sir?
Where is Sonali? I can't see her. Can Sonali come directly on screen?
Okay, that's fine. I think you can just answer the question. Yeah.
See, first of all, there is no wrong lifestyle. I was listening to one of the discussion between the some scholars, and they said that everyone has a different life rhythm. If your kid is born, maybe in the middle of the night or in the morning time, in the afternoon time, now you cannot change certain rhythms in the life of the kid. So ideas how to harness those rhythms and how to help the kid to harness those rhythms. That's the question you have to start answering and questioning yourself. Then 18 is a very, very dynamic age, and the child is full of energy, and most children, most parents feel quite jealous that youthfulness of the kid and the dynamism of their life, this lifestyle they have, the way they exhibit themselves, that quite surprises parents. So here we have to understand few things arising from the childhood days or otherwise. At every single point of time, you are offering them, what should I do for you? 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 And by this time of age, they are fully accustomed and conditioned that what will you do for me? Tell me. And parents, the internal mindset changes that he has to do for us. Okay. And they start expecting and seeing their vision of life that now this, my child has to be my kind of a supporter, or has to be illuminator of my own name, or khandan ka naam roshan karega. So if you check the metaphor in your mind, some metaphor that is ruling you and dominating you is in fact is obscuring you or blinding you or filtering you to in fact pay attention that what are the values in fact my child is trying to live by, and how do I humanize those values, and rather than seeing the differences or simply as the lifestyle management issues rather than the value issues. And this I would again say that, because when I don't have an idea of what value is, how will I in fact help other people? So most parents are not aware of even a simple definition of value, that what do you mean by value even. So that's where they fail to value the valuable in children, and this keep happening. So the summing up, my answer is, become aware of that, how I have been bringing up my kid, and now what are the values showing up, what are the values I have, and how do I help my kid in a very gentle, in a very engaging, involving manner to let the values find the expression through everything they are doing. And you also start searching what's so valuable when my kid is, you know, living this kind of a lifestyle, and get in touch with those values and start connecting with those values. And that's where aligning those values and connecting with those values will make the parenting very smooth going, easier and nice and fun filled, and a lot of thrill and joy will be there. So when I say thrill and joy will be there, yes, you will many a time get thrilled by that, what are they saying and what are they capable of, take challenges of life as, okay, they have their own mind, they have their own individuality. They might be okay with only 4.5 hours waking up or sleeping time, and you could be looking maybe 8 hours, 10 hours. They have a different way of valuing the study times and the play time. You have a different. So that's where you need to align yourself. I hope I got a good answer.
Sonali, I would just like to add to this, you know, because the question itself states that how do I approach him for this wrong lifestyle? The moment your perception is that it's wrong or right, you're coming from that paradigm. And when you think something is wrong, that is from your perception. It's very difficult to change the other person with your perceptions. So if you drop this idea of wrong and right, and if you simply see it as a situation, that son being 18 years old and he is sleeping at morning, and he's waking up at night and sleeping in the morning and eating at weird hours. So obviously when the child is awake at night, he would eat, he would not stay hungry. So if you simply ask the child that what is it about the rhythm that has happened to him, I don't know, because at this age, if the children are too studious, they study at night and then they wake up, they sleep in the morning. So that's a life cycle which I've had with some of the cases which have come to me. And the child says that I can study only at night because I'm very focused, and he sleeps the whole day. So you need to really first drop your own perception of wrong and right. That's my take for it. And then ask the child, what is it that this is happening? And what do you think that it's a reverse cycle? So what do you think that, is it right? Is it happening right? If it is not hampering the child in some way or the other, right? As per our system of normal, what we are doing is obviously we sleep at night and wake up in the morning. But then still, I think I would suggest that you ask the child that why this cycle has happened and how, if this has to be broken, if he has to go to college or he has to go to school, then obviously we need to work in a reverse way. So that would be my answer to you. I hope this answers your questions. We have another question from Pooja. She says, sir, I wanted to know that what fears are reasonable and, what fears are reasonable and what are not? Is it necessary to instill even a little fear in a child?
Every fear is real and every fear is unreal. So when you draw a line between safety and you understand where the human life is safe or not, and where we endanger others is only the harmful fear. So like, touching the live wire or walking on fire or touching the fire, right? On the wrong side of the road. So just check within you. It's a very common way of understanding. So develop your own sense of knowing from within and you will know it. Otherwise the list will become too elaborate to answer you. However, what scares you, and in the name of care, if you scare other person and you influence, you try to bend the plant growing in the direction of where the plant is finding the light for the fear of the sunlight will burn it, just because you're getting little more heat, I don't think it would be a good idea there. So it's just knowingness within you will let you know that which fears are real and unreal. However, remember, the reality in your mind is always so real that you forget what the real is. The rope in your mind can be so scary that you might not even look at, or you might start looking at this, you looking at snake is anywhere, right? So even right now, in the mind, the COVID is there and you're looking for everywhere. So that's the internal reality is very real. So just give it a check. What's not real and what's real in my head? You will be able to compare it. So I call it the yellow ball syndrome. If you imagine if you see a yellow ball in front of you and you close your eyes and imagine a yellow ball, you would see a ball in your mind, which is the imagined one, the right one. But if you create a yellow ball in your head, if you create a ball in front of you and now imagine, it'll be far more vivid and clear in your mind. So I call it yellow ball syndrome. So check within, what have I created in mind which is not there at all? And in the name of care, I'm scaring. That's very dangerous. Okay.
So we have Vidya. Can you please ask your question? You have raised your hand.
One more question we have missed.
No, we haven't missed because Vidya has raised the question. So I'm looking at the questions. Yes, Vidya. So can you please ask your question before we go to
Yes. Yeah. Hello, sir. So this is regarding, I have twin daughters. So they are 11 years, they will be turning 12 now. So one of them is having learning disability, and due to which what happens is she struggles a lot. I can see her that she is working very hard. However, in comparison with my another daughter who is Gauri, she always scores late, which makes her lose her confidence. And in school also then becomes all the more difficult for her to handle the situation. So she is very quiet, she is very silent when in the school, but at home, exactly opposite. She's creative. Her drawing skills, coloring skills are very nice. She is hard worker also. She knows that she is having learning disability. However, while working, it makes her difficult to work out. So how can I deal with her?
Okay. So you want to answer first, or do you want me to take up?
I think you can go ahead because I feel it's a very long question and something you can answer, then probably Vijay, I can also speak to you differently over the phone and tell you certain more things. In the meanwhile, sir, we'll answer you. Yeah.
Now, Vijay, you look at your statement and then look at that, you, the kid whom you call has a learning disability, has learned to remain less confident so quickly. So yes. Where is the learning disability? Child has learned to fear, child has learned to, you know, feel small or less. So there's no learning disability. The unfortunate part is, we learned the neurolinguistic programming from Richard Bandler, who's the co-creator of the NLP intervention. He once made the children, teachers to go out of school and took charge of those also learning disabled children. He said, there's no learning disabled children. They're only learning disabled teacher. And they do not know how to teach them. So because we have a standard pattern of teaching and we are not customizing teaching to the need of the child. So if you become quite good educated and I do not know, school cannot be taught. In fact, there is no child that is learning disabled until very, very extreme case, okay? Who was born with some deformities and otherwise. But in fact, they have a unique way of learning, which most of the parents or the teachers do not understand. So if you find out that what is the good, profound way my child will learn, so you have to be a little more curious now because you have a double responsibility that teachers fail to take. So if you value learning, if you value being human, if you value that it is okay, then there could be several things your child will be very good in learning very fast. Only thing is, if you're forcing the child to square up and take the equal education, then I think you need to first learn that what can I make my child learn, which my child can be so fast. And that's what the human being is, that when one of the ability is retarded, the another of the abilities accelerated. But
I think she also did mention that the child is very, very creative at home. Right, Vijaya? Yeah.
Right.
That's
right.
What you, so if you can, kind of channel her creativity and put her in a different way where she can use her creativity. It's not necessary all of us have to, you know, become engineers and doctors and even we have to do 12th standard
for what? That is true.
Right. So if you remember, see, I always tell all the people who come to me, what we have studied, even I have studied in school, even you have studied history, geography, you have studied mathematics, but where is it coming in use? And if the child is not able to do that, if the child is good in creativity, in dancing, in singing, in drawing, why don't you put her abilities there and make her a good artist, make her a good singer, make her a good dancer? Right? And maybe if you do that, whatever she has to study, she will study. If she doesn't, that's also okay. That's perfectly all right. That's my
way of looking at it. Yes, that is true. And that is the thing we are telling her repeatedly. However, she on her own starts comparing herself with Kauri. So at that time, then again, we have to start from the square one. Ki nahi aisa nahi hai. Everybody is different. Everybody is unique. Everybody is having different intelligence level. You are more creative. She is less creative. So I need to compare these things and then make her realize that you are also equally good as of Gauri.
Good.
Vijaya, put yourself a question day and night. What do I have to be learning able to make my child forgo this learning inability? If you put this question to yourself, what abilities I need to increase myself?
And that's a very good question.
Let my child have any inability or disability. Right? This question will continuously bring something more from you. If you are a mother, you have been specifically placed there for this purpose and reason. Right? And I'm pretty sure that and every human being has been given only a problem which they can solve. And not ever beyond that. Provided you don't think that's a problem and you think that's not even a challenge, you think there's an opportunity.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you, Vijaya. So we have a question from Jamshed. He says, value conscious parenting needs to be based on fundamental values. And where is these values picked up from?
Okay. So any set of values have been only picked up from welfare of humanity. What is being human? all values are derivatives of just being human. Identify that being a human, who you are, what do you want? And the very fundamental value every human being has is of a good health. But the question here is, if you really remember the very first slide, that we start going by what my child likes and what's available and what the mass generation is eating. So the value of health even start missing. So think about it that. So answer to you is very simple. Human being, being human, what you value are the fundamental values. And how my every other value, which is derivative of the fundamental human values, are predefined values. We are born with those predefined set of values. That's called our dharma. Then from the dharma, it comes out our swadharma. That now what is my individual values coming out of it? And what is I can now bring in so valuable in my kid? So just pay attention on the fundamental human need or human survival or human worth. That's the basis of all values.
Okay, I know Satnam, you're raising your hand, but I have Harshita. So Harshita, you want to ask a question, please ask. Harshita, if you're around.
I had a query that sometimes we always say that children observe their parents or probably their elders and they tend to bring it the same. But I many a times fall to see that we are not indisciplined, we don't create a mess, we don't scream, we are not into gadgets throughout the day, we are not into comparison probably so many times. But the basic problem with the teens from especially 12, in fact, I should not say 12, from 10 to 18, it's so much about the peers, so much about looking into others' lives. It's so much about that that it's become difficult, really difficult for a parent to handle the child, the situation we have to be in. The values to put in becomes really difficult because we see that other people are doing and maybe the negativity, catching negativity is really easy. So how do we handle such situations?
Okay. First of all, I can't see your name. What's your name?
Harshita.
Harshita. Harshita, I want to give you very good news. Drop this guilt from you that parents are your mirror. Parents are the your reflection, who you are. It is not true. If you look into the human history, the like especially Indian mythology, even person like Prahlad could not take anything what his father was. He failed to take, right? Now, the only thing that you have to start paying attention towards is that what are my real tendencies of my child? Because when child picks up based on what they are wanting around, it could be not you, it could be anyone. It could be even no one around, even their imagination. Out of the imagination, that means seeing a movie even. They have no to go to anyone. Even from that, they can pick up anything because that's what the human mind is. So if you become aware of that, how quick learner human being is, and based on what the innate desires, innate tendencies, mind bends, they'll pick up any behavior. You will start observing their behaviors. And when your attention will go on towards their behavior, you will disconnect with their values. And you will start comparing to, and you will start looking into me. So I have seen even spiritual leaders, with my all respect to them, very, very intelligent leaders. They say, do not do those things what you don't want your children to, whether you do or you don't do. Children are they themselves. And you have to really find that it is one species of intelligence come through me and is not me. And nor do anything but I have maybe necessarily taken by my kid. Not you. There are thousands of people around them ready to influence them, or they themselves are. So you have to stop blaming yourself. Start reaching deep inside them. And that requires immense love, immense insight, immense peace of mind. And the thing is, you're talking about a time which is quite late, I believe. But think about it that hardly, somebody just asked a question, fundamental value. How many of us at the age when you're teaching them how to you know, assemble this piece, how to play with this doll. Let me understand, how many of the parents really at that time inculcate what peace is, what being calm is, what being sitting is, what being sitting with yourself is. We think that this is not their age to learn. So in fact, because we don't value these things and we don't value there that tender time, we miss the train. And then we find the tendencies in them finding the impression. They could be finding immense peace and they could be ending up in brutal anger. Okay, just because they're not getting their peace. So you start paying attention of value conscious parenting is become conscious of values, what's really valuable at a much age, but still no time is lost. Even now, begin and start doing it. See, you can add.
Yeah, so Harshita, I would just like to add, you know, because that's a very crucial age, especially 12 to 18 and 12 to 14 more so. So you cannot stop them, you know, from the influences because they have to go out, they have to be with the peers, and they have to also learn from them. What my understanding with the various kind of coaching I've done, and also I've counseled the parents and the kids as well, instead of, you know, kind of pushing them and pulling them and telling them this is not good, don't do this, it doesn't work with any human being. Think about your own self when you were children. When parents told you not to do it, you in your mind had more so, let me try, what will happen, I will do it, right? That's with every human being, okay? They might get, you know, you might suppress a child that the child will not do it, but there's always question remaining. So if you, for the first time, if the child goes out and you have, let's say there are gadgets, there's an iPhone you're giving straight away to the child. One is because of the technology, you cannot avoid not giving it to them because otherwise they will be left behind because that's a part, that's a whole technological growth of the whole humanity. So we cannot leave them behind with that. But the other thing is to tell them that, look, this is what is happening. I am giving you all this. This will do this, 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 this. Now you choose what do you really want to do with it. And which I, one thing which I always tell, you know, as a part of value conscious parenting, I always tell, I don't know if it's good for you or not, or all of you are listening to it, if it works for you, that, you know, parents are always with the children. When I say always, I really mean always. And that's what has been at least inculcated in an Indian human mindset that you will be always with the child. If you tell your child that I am there as your mother, I am there as your father, even if you do something wrong, I'm there behind you and besides you. Right now, if you're going to do this, this will result in this. And if you do this, this is going to result in this. So you choose. You choose which one do you think is much more valuable to you. And at least to my experience, wherever I have handled people, handled children, children have always chosen what parents think is right or what is right for them. I'll just give you an example. One of the, you know, I was coaching one of the parent, and he says, I'm always confronting with my daughter. She's in 10th standard. And he says she goes for the tuitions, and she was based out of Chennai. She says in Chennai, it's so hot. And then the buses, she doesn't want to travel. So she was always pushing her father to get a scooty for her all the time. She says, Siri, when I'm sitting in the table, lunchtime, dinner time, we always end up in fight. And I don't like my doing that with my daughter at all. And I don't know how to handle it. So then I said, okay, why don't you just ask her that? What is it, Sherry, you wanting? So I give her a reason that I don't have money, but actually I have money, I can afford it, but I don't want to do because I have a lot of fear. Because if something happens to her, what do I do? So I said, have you ever told this to your child? So he says, no. So I said, okay, let's do one thing. Today when you go back, what you will do is you will put your fear on the table first. That look, child, I have this fear, I have insecurity. It is my insecurity. You might be a good person, you might learn. And he made her learn driving, but he doesn't let her drive. But this is my fear. So what do you think? How can you help this? And I can afford to buy you scooty. It's not that I don't have money. It's only because of my fear I'm not doing it. So he says, you tell me today, and then tomorrow morning I go and buy you a scooty. So he said, he came back, you know, we were having a session, and he came back in the afternoon and said, Siri, it's really amazing. Said, my girl came to me in the morning and said, Papa, I think I can wait till my 12th standard. And I understand you have a fear. So I will wait. I will go buy my bus only. So if we try to make them understand what are your intentions, what are your values that you hold, even if a parent is shouting on a kid, right? Let's say the child is crossing a road and is not listening to you and you're shouting. Actually, you're shouting out of love, to care, and your fear that child might not get hurt. But if you do not convey this to your children, children do not understand it. So every time we are behaving in a way and our children become adept to the behavior and they do not understand the real value that you hold for them. So that is my thought. If you can think, you can do like this with your children. Tell them, this is what, I'm going to get you everything what your friend has. So this is the value it holds. So what do you think is what you would like to do on it? Because at this age, there are a lot of false anchors are also created. My friend is doing this, so I would like to do this. And that's very, very normal. So if you understand them deeply and touch their hearts, what Sir said, you sit with yourself peacefully and then touch their hearts. I can tell you it can bring amazing results with the children. Amazing results. I hope Harshita did answer your question.
I think probably I end up with two conclusions. One thing is that I love them and I explain them every time that they need to do this because I think it is right for the XYZ reason. Because there are a couple of things which I see because both my kids lie in this age of 12 to 16. Mm-hmm. So what I see is very small things. Probably as a mother, people say you take it on your head. It's not really very necessary. But there are some basics which I need to probably repeat for the thousands of times. And maybe I'm not doing it in the right direction. Like a basic thing of picking up your own clothes or taking up your own utensils. Those are basics actually. Mm. So do I need to tell them again and again every time?
Okay, ask yourself a question that if they will not do it, what will happen then?
Honestly, I did that also. If they are not doing it, I really did it that for 2 days. I didn't took that dirty utensils. For 2 days, I didn't took that dirty clothes.
As a mother, Harshita, if you do it every time, what it will take?
They're not going to do it. They'll say either of the days, Mama is going to do it. The scream, she'll say, but she'll
okay.
do it.
So, okay, even so if you do it, let's say you will do it for many years, then what will happen? Is it very big thing?
I'll end up with a chit-chit always.
So then, see, that chit-chit is going in your head. Because in your mind, you have made a kind of a rule that my children are good if they pick up the utensils. My children are good if they pick up their own clothes. What if they don't? You are a mother, you do it. That's it.
Enjoy.
My son says, what if I don't?
Sorry?
He says the same, Mama boy, what if I don't pick up? That's okay. He's like, that's okay.
So it's, you have to understand that you are getting troubled by the discomfort you have created in your mind and your head. They are very comfortable with what they are doing, putting the utensils, not picking it up. They're very comfortable. It's only your discomfort which is bothering you.
Yes, actually.
So then you make that discomfort. If you really love them, then you will pick up it. You will pick up the things, you know.
I do it, but I end up with a chit-chat only that every time I have to do it.
So then we have to put you right. We have to put you right, not the children. Okay, yeah. For this matter. Thank you so much. Yeah.
And your mother need, how do I parent my kid?
Okay. So thank you so much. You can also write to us, Harshita, and you can talk to us later on. I really appreciate that. Yes, Satnam, you've been raising your hand for a long time. Ankur, I cannot see. I think you were earlier raising your hand. Are you still there, Ankur? I'm not able to see him.
Yes, ma'am, I'm still here.
Okay, so because your hand has been, you have probably put down your hand. So do you have a question?
No, I got disconnected in. I got disconnected in me.
Okay, so you have a question to ask? Then okay. I'll come back to Satna. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am, I have a question.
Please.
Yeah, the question is, ma'am, considering the kind of exposure kids have these days, there is really very little we as parents can do. What will influence them, positive, negative, in whichever way they may get influenced. Only little thing that I think we can do is inculcating good values in them and making them understand the consequences. However, in today's world, even that has become difficult because the amount of time children are willing to spend with their parents and when they are surrounded with gadgets and their studies and their friends and all, it becomes very difficult to pass on those values which we learned or which our parents learned, which we know are good and will help them in future. What future course they take is all their freedom, and there is no force on them that you should become a doctor or engineer. But yes, the values remain universal, and should there be any methodical way of inculcating values, or we should just leave it to chance as and when a situation arises, we should deal with it and try to inculcate it. Because time is flying. My elder son is 12 years old, entering into his teens, and all those typical teenager situations have started arising. So what's your take on this? How do we organize this thing to, you know, value education? Because I don't expect much from the Indian education system and from the school. I mean, it just eye wash that is happening in the education system.
So the question is that how should you inculcate the values in a 12-year-old kid, right? That's what you're asking.
Yes, yes. What method we should use to inculcate value education? That's the question.
Ankur, my learning and understanding with working with so many people is, first, to get to the values, you have to become a friend of your 12-year-old kid, which is very difficult for a parent to do it. Because what you think, you know, like I remember we had one of our students who had come in for the program, and for her, and she is one of the, you know, fashion stylist. So she says, for me, you know, it's like both the kids have to be really, you know, tip top with hair done, going out well-dressed, and they can't be shabby and everything around it, you know. And she says, every time I have a discussion and every time I scold them, because my son especially doesn't listen to me and he goes with all the hair in a different direction, and I don't like it. So I said, what happens then? She says, because of that, there's a kind of rift happening every time we end up in quarreling and fighting, and then he still doesn't listen to me. I said, okay. I said, what about his friends? So Zaya, you know, when he comes back, he said, my friends really praise me. What a hairstyle you've got. How smart you're looking, you know. And what is happening to that kid? Imagine. Because right now at this age, 12 is an age when your friends have become much more important than a parent. Because you're always acting like a parent. Okay. So what you need to understand, the first value a parent needs to understand is that is an age when all of us have also gone through our own hormonal change, our attractions have changed, everything, it happens to every human being. So if you understand that as a good friend, if you become a good friend and you do not hold him back for everything that the child is doing, first of all, for me, there's nothing like right and wrong. That's my learning. Because whatever is right for you may be wrong for your kid. Whatever is wrong for you may be right for your kid, because it is his age and his learning style. So if you have some basic values, which we talk about as humanity, if you inculcate that if you are honoring yourself, you have to honor the other human being. If you have love for your family, yes, you have to have love for
that family. I am talking about.
Right? So then you have to only at the time when the child is receptive. So you cannot hold a child. You can scold a child and make him sit. You have scolded him. What you have done, you have gone out, you have played on the summer, you have this heat, and then you expect the child to learn. Child will never learn. So as a child, it's not, again, we have also understood, it's not about stepping into the shoes of it, but it's becoming a child. The moment you will become a child with the child, you'll be able to understand the mindset. And as a coach, Ankur, if you ask more questions, okay, what do you enjoy when you go out? What happens with your friends? Kitna maza aata hai? Kya karte ho? Khelte ho? Kitna acha lagta hai? You know, papa ne to wo kaam hi nahi kiya. What you all have done? Once a child opens up, that is the only time the child will become receptive to you. But if you keep pushing and pulling and drawing your own controls, now this is not good, that is not good. At least from my understanding, it's very difficult for you to even inculcate values. Right? And that's the age, even if you do certain things which are good, they still don't learn, because the friends are talking in a different language than what you're talking altogether. Okay, Ankur?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so sir can take it forward.
Yeah, so I want to say that learn to take no of your child in a very matured, playful, and in a very loving manner. And don't get perturbed by that, you know. Why my kid has not removed the pots from here? Like one of the participants typing that they will get into the wrong habits. Who knows? Who knows they will get into the wrong habit? Who knows that they will get into many, many good habits that so many people will be there to serve them. So let's not talk this will. Fear of your mind, do not impose upon one rule that is not being followed by. You start.
No, sir, may I?
Yeah?
Sorry to interrupt. Sir.
Okay. So start developing. Yeah. Any question?
No, sir, you please carry on. Sir, I'll speak in the end.
Okay. So start developing a good value in you that is inclusive of the surrounding and the kid has it. And there is no way that if you have time and attention, the things will not show up. The only thing is most parents are very short of time. And when they are with them, they want to be in those times do things. But like Sri told, there are always time when people are receptive and they are adaptive. However, most people use the trick and trade method that if you give me this, I'll do this. If you don't do this, then I will not do this. So they also become tricky and trading. So trick and trade doesn't work. The engaging, involving, allowing, and then with them enjoying the process will work, which I believe I haven't seen many parents doing it. Right? So just give it a chance. Any question further?
The question was not that I don't have a good relationship or not very friendly with my son or don't have those moments which you just mentioned. The question was related to it is not just about fun and frolic and you know we have a good time and understand what the child wants and what he doesn't want and giving him his freedom. It is not about that. What I meant to ask is, say if I have to teach him or educate him about becoming a better person or how to become a better selection, how to make better selection of choices in life or how which values are good and which values are not good. So should I wait for an incident to happen and should I give my mind to him when such situation arises, or should I adopt a method or a system wherein we have a set time or set way of sharing the? That was my question. Otherwise, whatever all you both said is absolutely understood and point taken, sir. But my question was primarily on to the method of how to educate a child on values.
No, it's a very, very specific question to different situation. I can only give my mind into it. That my mind is, you wait for the right moment when they are most receptive, but do not look for every single moment. Hunter. Don't hunt for those times.
I don't want to be in that mode. Okay, अरे अभी मौका मिला अभी इसको सिखाता हूँ वो नहीं लेना है sir. So, I don't want to make that mistake. Okay? I'm always on prowl and I'm always on. Okay, when he speaks, I will take revenge and I will tell him what right, what not. Thank you so much, sir. I think I've got my answer.
Good. Okay. So,
Satnam. Okay, Satnam is raising his hand.
So he's quite up, must be tired, you know. Okay.
Yes, Satnam.
Yes.
Satnam, we can't hear you. You are on mute. Yes. Satnam, you're
can on you mute. See? Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Now you can.
Okay. Thanks a lot. Firstly, ma'am, extremely grateful to both of you for having taken the time and trouble to bring the. And this topic is really godsend, something which is extremely live. And thank you very much for taking on the questions and coming up. So the question I want to ask is there are two things that are coming up which have a clash of values and as well as some problem with the parents. One is watching phone and second is playing PUBG.
Playing?
PUBG. There's a game, which online game, PUBG.
It's
a very addictive game.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's a very addictive game. If you start playing it, people are saying, I've tried it. And before it became addiction, I sort of deleted it, but it's very addictive. That is one. And second is porn is freely available on the phone. Every child has. Now, parents have this every time that he wants to study late, and I know what is he doing. I said, what is he doing? He is watching porn or is playing PUBG. So these are two addictions, actually. Very, very attractive. And PUBG is a very, easily people discuss. Children of that age, they tend to discuss a lot about what stage did you reach. And pornography, due to sheer factor of being at a certain age and easy availability, they get addicted. And I just want to know, so how do we go about, I don't know whether we can stop them fully, but how do we control the addiction to PUBG game and pornography?
Okay, I'll take the answer only from one paradigm, that any addiction, is like, in the Indians it would describe as that the kutta ke muh mein haddi, like that. People start enjoying, this is the reverse psychology. People start enjoying something that is harming them, and that secretes very, very powerful hormones and chemicals that is, they almost sometimes become irreversible. However, when it becomes addiction, this definitely requires, working at a person. So there are lots of techniques there which can be used. If a person is aware of that, how thinking work, how the mind work, how the brain works, okay, then using certain other things, like even food also have certain chemistries which can do the reversal in the addictive neurology. The question is that somewhere parents have not paid attention. This stage arises. This doesn't build up in a day.
Yeah,
so, because only thing is that it is caught up quite late. Then it is too late for any person to handle it. So it requires a very deep specialization. And I always tell people that even in the early time, it was true that people wanted to be in Gurukul. So that time only the gurus and the acharyas were there to help children to really inculcate and get in touch with the values so that they don't drift from being human ever. And being human is never being addictive. This is very sure. This means today every parent has to be a guru ma and guru pita to in fact really, really, really help the kid to and nurture the seed of value. Every human being is born to in fact do something good. And the environments will be always catchy, addictive. And you are perfectly right. It's a very, very beautiful question you have asked. I think it will illuminate and enlighten many parents that remember that every industry is so designed, even every food which is addictive. It could be any food. I won't take any name because I don't want to be against any food. The thought pattern behind designing that food, the package of food, the way it will open up, the way it will crackle in the mouth, it is such that it secretes very, very powerful addictive hormones, addictive chemicals in the brain, and people will soon become addictive. In fact, the study shows the most of the packaging industry and the ready-made food that you buy from the market, the most of the industry is handled by the alcohol manufacturer, and they are very, very good in creating the addictive size of, I think, even if you take the name of the whiskey bottle, you are so addictive to see the shape and the size of that bottle that you buy that. So the answer here is it requires a specialization in the parents. So they have to spend some money on themselves to educate, to deal with this challenge and work at children, keeping the value of upbringing, nurturing and responsibility, accountability in mind, and pay dedicated time to it and help people to help their children drop those patterns step by step. It is possible. Okay. Or they have to take a specialization, help from someone, or can help them to drop these addictive patterns. And even while building up times, they'll be very much aware of that, how to in fact change the internal perception, thought process, images in the mind. So all this has to be handled very, very carefully by all the parents. And now in the future time, it's going to be more and more in demand. So the mental health is going to be a big challenge, and it is a definitely mental health problem. So responsibility on people like you and everyone who's listening is capable, and parents to become themselves capable to help children drop those addictive patterns is a specializing task, has to be handled very, very carefully. And no matter what, it could be the Ayurvedic, it could be the yogic principle, it could be the way mental thought process work, and or your communication work, even the way I must communicate so that unconsciously I help my kid. You have to learn all these ways of interactional excellence to deal with your own kid. A time was, it was required for a professional. But today, every parent has to be either seeking help. If they can't seek help, they very quick and seek help. I can't wash my utensils, so I should get a maid. I can't wash clothes, so let me get another maid. I can't clean floor, let me get another maid. So they seek help for everything. But they don't seek help for when the child is getting addictive pattern. They only crib, shout, scream, yell, force, control. It is not going to help. Specialization help is a specialization help. So the answer is, it's possible. Take special help. Become the specialist.
So in a coaching scenario, so should we, is there any technique which will work on, see, parents are very phobic, but does it need another somebody else who is an addiction specialist?
Yes.
I think in such cases, when it's about the addiction, we need some kind of counseling or addiction specialist, Satnam. Coaching is not something, it can work, but not to that level what you're looking forward for it. If it's an addiction, it needs to be somebody who knows how to handle addictions.
It's a work at. Yeah. Working at.
Like that's it. Because it's a live situation I'm having, but so I was wondering what technique, what anything of the things, but it's not going to work. Because they already think of it.
You have learned those patterns. You have learned all the patterns.
See, it's more of coaching the parents and also counseling them and also counseling the children if they are open for it. But there has to be a way. It has to be somebody who is kind of a specialist in handling the addiction. So that is important. What sir said is very correct. So we need somebody who specializes in that area to handle it.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. So we have Neeta. It has one of Neeta. You can ask a question. Neeta, sir, Neeta, you are there?
Yeah. Sir, I do have a question with regard to first this, then another question. What if the child denies doing that?
Denying what?
Denying like playing PUBG or watching pornography, and they do avoid any discussion on that.
So first of all, Neeta, when they are denying something, why they are denying it? Let me ask you this question. Why they are denying it that they are not doing it? Can you tell me?
Because they don't want to tell it to their parents that they are doing such things.
Okay. So let me ask you this question another way. If it has happened many of our times in our lives also, that we have also denied certain things to our parents or loved ones or even to a friend. The main reason of denying is what? And if you go inside and understand... Sorry?
Because this is not considered good thing to do.
Right. So they have a fear that it is not good. And if I tell them, I will either get a bashing or a scolding or they will take away my phone. So it is coming out of fear. So the child will definitely deny it because it's been told that it is not good and it's definitely not good to get addicted to anything for that matter. But if you say it's an addiction, just to answer all of you, we are all addicted to something in our life. Child can be addicted to PUBG or something else. We are addicted to a food. People are addicted to the work. So we all have different addictions in different areas of life. It's not that we are not. You check in within yourself. We have some addiction. Could be talking on the phone, could be sleeping, could be resting, could be just anything for us in the life. So if it is a child who's denying it, that means somewhere you have created a boundary of fear that the child will not accept because you said it's wrong. And if you do it, if you are caught, the child will get something or the other, which is kind of a punishment. So because of the fear of punishment, the child is denying.
Adjust your mic, see?
Okay, right? Mm-hmm. That is one part of it, right? And obviously then the child will deny any kind of discussion over it. On the other hand, if you are dealing with such a person, if you are a parent, and as sir already said, it's about handling it with more care and somebody who specializes in such things has to be handled. First of all, they have to come out of this judgment that it is right or wrong. this has happened. The person has been, the child has been playing a game and it's gone overboard where it has become like an addiction and the child does not know how to come out of it, even if the child wants to. Even if some corner of the mind knows that this is not right, I've got addicted to it, but they don't know how to do it. So if you can handle with a lot of care and extreme, extreme love, then only such cases can be handled by a parent. Otherwise, parents are so emotionally attached, they are in so much of right and wrong, then it becomes difficult for them to even handle that such kind of a situation. So, sir, you can answer it.
Yeah, so I would say specialization. Become specialists. Guru Maas, Guru Pitas, or go to some guru of that. Ask, I think, if you have a general problem, there are a lot many out here who specialize in, you know, dealing with the children's mind.
Absolutely.
So take help. Don't delay it.
So we have Jamshed ji. I'm not able to.
I do have one more question.
Yeah, Anita, can I just take the Jamshed ji's question? Then I'll come back to you. Right? Because he's been, I am not able to see him somewhere. Jamshed ji, are you there? I don't know if he's there or not. Okay, I'm not able to see.
He had typed his question earlier.
We had taken up his question, Prosperity. That was related to the values. After that, I haven't seen any question from him after that. I think he's not there also.
Yeah.
So, Neeta, you can continue your question. You can ask.
Okay. It is with regard to a situation which I happen to have with my daughter.
Mm-hmm.
She's studying in Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And she was very, very busy with the classes because classes were happening from 8 to 8 and she was working also on weekends. So she was unable to complete her assignments.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then she was too stressed. So I helped her completing her assignments at that time. But I told her that this is the only time I'm doing it. Next time I will not do it because you have to do it on your own because you need to build your skills yourself. Otherwise you will not be building your skills. Mm-hmm. Okay. And now she is doing her assignments on her own and I told her not to work if it is giving you stress.
Mm.
So you just focus on your studies and building your skills. So my first question is, at the very first place, was I doing right helping her in her assignments?
When you did it that time, Neeta, that was also right. And later on, when you told her that you will not help her, let her do it, that was also right. So whatever came from you, both were right only. Is she doing well now, according to you?
Yeah, she is doing well. She has stopped working now. So she is just focusing on doing the assignments.
Good. Then that's good. If it's working for her, you've done right only.
Okay. Thank you. But I had a guilt that she did not do it on her own and I had helped her.
It's like you think that you were helping your child to write ABCD. When she's fully learned it, you said, now you can write an essay. So you've done a good job like a mother.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Okay.
So anyone else? Jamshedji, I'm not able to see. So if anybody has any questions, otherwise.
Yeah, time is to wind up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I have one query. Can I ask?
Okay, ask. Yeah. So we'll take the last question. Yes, Vijaya.
Okay. So my another daughter, who is Gauri, she is having fear about small insects. Mm-hmm. So she is like, ki ghar mein ek bhi small insect, including machhar and anything should not come inside. So she is like closing all the doors all the time.
Mm.
So I want her to get out of this fear. So what can I apply with her?
You have learned the technique of how to come out of fear, no? When you came to the program.
Yes.
If you don't remember it, then probably somebody else can do it for her, but we have already talked to that.
Okay. I will try to do that with her. When it comes to your own kid, it becomes difficult.
So then you take help. See, then that is already told you. If we cannot do something, if I'm not a doctor, I go to a doctor, right? And if I'm not, I don't know how to cook, I'll keep a cook. But if you cannot help your child, just take help. There's so many people available. We are there. We have a whole group of people whom we have done the workshop with. So many of them are available. Take help.
Right. Okay.
Right?
Right.
Okay.
Okay, very nice contribution question. I think good comments are also there.
We have one more question. Pawan is raising his hand, so Pawan will take your question as last. Pawan, you can.
Yeah. Yes. Sure. Thank you. Just checking with you, both of you people, that you know, when we're talking about children, different age groups, be it the younger lot, 5 to 7 years old, senior lot, 8 to 12, and 13 to 18. At each of these four stages of childhood, from childhood to teens, there's anger coming across at different aspects. Childhood में होता है कि भाई मुझे चीज नहीं मिली तो I will throw a tantrum. Okay, when they are getting a little older, you know, मेरे friend के पास है, मेरे पास नहीं है, and they start reacting in a different way. For small things, the anger is coming out, and when the hormonal changes happen, obviously, you know, they don't understand why and how. All of us have gone through that. So when we are talking about these 3 to 4 different age groups, how do we help these children to deal or understand the anger, especially as parents?
See, I think I can only sort of give you some examples of it. Tessa can also elaborate after that. I have my niece, nephew's daughter, 3-year-old kid. So it's very ironical. Side by side, it's also, she has to learn it. There's no other way. So if you don't give her the thing, obviously she will get angry. You know? And then we don't want her to cry because she's the only girl in our family after so many years. So everybody's like, she's the most loved child because she's like, we don't have all males most of the time in our family. So we don't let her also cry. And that's, I don't know, fortunate or not. But then, yes, we do make her understand. And she's just 3+. She gets annoyed. She cries at times. And we allow her to cry. But because she's crying, so her mother, including all of us and mother, we will not give her the thing what she's asking for. After some time, when she's okay, because children are, that time it is such a wonderful age, and believe it for me, I've learned a lot from her. The moment she is crying, the next moment, even if she's got annoyed from me, after 2 minutes, I'll pick her and tell her another story, and she's happy and laughing with me. When she does that in the most sweetest manner, what she can understand with her toys and whatever she has around, we just make her understand that if you cry, the things will not be given to you, because crying doesn't mean that you will get this thing. But if you are happy, you are, you know, kind of peaceful, or you are whatever way you behave, we'll give it. But on the other hand, Pawan, it's very important also for the child to get angry, because they will not learn it otherwise. So when you're saying we have to make them get angry, they must learn how to be angry, because once they grow up and if something is not happening, they're saying something on the street happening which is not good, they also need to learn about anger, because if they're not angry, they will not learn to even defend themselves. So it works both the ways. Now you have to understand which value are you coming from. If, and there are many parents who have done this, because both the parents are working, because the child cries, cry, child shouts, child is getting angry, so better give the things to child, because they'll be more peaceful at. So then it's a wrong kind of value inculcating in a child. So if you, how you make them grow at different ages depends on you entirely. You know, it's like you are making your children grow and you are kind of helping them to grow in a way. I have had cases where people have come, my parents were like very bossy, they were very strict, they had all the control, but I will never do that with my children. In spite of saying that, they still end up doing it, because that's the way you have learned. Nobody can avoid that. So you have to really, really understand the child from the child's perspective only. Being a child, what's happening to the child? So at different ages, they are going through different phases of life, and that's how they are being built up. So at times, anger is good. At times, anger is also not good. So we have to balance both the things according to the learnings what you have and what you're giving it to the child. Okay? And dealing with differently, different ages, yes, absolutely required, because people have, you have in the younger age, they are more listening to you, what you're doing, they are understanding. So I always, you know, sometimes I take these classes for the women who are pregnant and they're about to deliver. And I always tell them, in the initial years, whatever you are talking consciously or unconsciously, even the child is sleeping, everything is going into the conscious of the child. So either you become aware of that. If you haven't, then when the child has become aware, then also at the age of, till the age of 3 to 5, they are seeing what you're doing and they tend to copy it, right? So if you're calling your child, you know, like you are my kid, the child calls the toy that she's my kid. You can't help because the child just does that exactly. So at different ages, you will have to deal them in a very, very different way. And I think we have all gone through it. And plus a little learning about the language that you're talking to them, the way you're expressing your things, the way, instead of, again, kind of putting the things onto them, rather asking them when they're enough, good enough to make you understand by certain words that what it really means to them. So you can go ahead.
All right. Before we end, I just want to say one thing, that care not to be the, like, not to miss the opportunity to partner with your child. However, remain aware of that. If your long-term vision with the children is the seed of that you're saying today, sowing today. So I'll just relate a story that Siri faced. It might give you insight. At the age of maybe nearly 55 or so, one of the top directors of a big company cried brutally before Siri, and he said, my son is not bothered to send my birthday gift yesterday, and he went abroad. First, he used to send $10,000, then it reduced to $8,000, then it reduced to $3,000, then it reduced to $1,000, then it reduced to certain occasions, and now it is reduced to missing even a birthday gift. He was crying brutally. And she asked, when did you sow this seed? And he said, why would I sow my seed? I just did everything for him. I sent him abroad, I did everything. He said, when did you sow this seed? My child, I don't need you. And she transgressed him to a time. He said, I think I've been always telling my child, I don't think I need you. When he was in school, I told him, better school is more important than me. Job is more important than me. Family is more important than me. So at every moment when you keep telling child, what you do is more important than me or us or family, it does come back. So if you are prepared, do it consciously. Yeah, I really don't need you at any point of time in my life. Or prepare them, nurture them. And definitely last point, not kid, become angry. We are born with anger. Just remove that mental image of that children are born like Krishnas and Lalas. No. We are born with anger, hatred, demand, everything. We are born not clean slate. We are born with tendencies, and become a specialist to handle those tendencies. If you are not living this truth and accepting this truth, at every moment you are waiting for another deception. Those are my final words. And now, yeah, you see?
So thank you so much, everyone, for...
Okay, so thank you, everyone. Just a very quick thing. So next week we'll have a coaching session, of course, by sir and ma'am. And we will have it on eliciting the values of you as a parent and of your child. So whoever is interested, please do apply for it. The mail is going to come to you tomorrow. And also, anyone you think is going to benefit from attending such a coaching session, please do forward the link to those people. The link is always given to you at the end of the mail. Okay, so please forward the link to anyone who's going to be interested in the session on eliciting values of you as a parent and of your child, so that you can actually align those values and have a better parent-child relationship. Also, in case Ankur, the subject is it's going to be a coaching session next week by sir and ma'am, and it's going to be on eliciting values, okay, as a parent and that of your child. So, of course, it's going to be there in detail. And also, if you have any suggestions you have on the topics that can be covered next, please reply back on the mail itself. So, you know, we can streamline those topics. You can see how we can take it forward. So thank you very much, Siri, please.
So I would like to just thank Prosperity. It is really, really her hard work. You know, she's putting so much of work in all these mails and everything. So it's her initiative. We are taking it forward. And every time she keeps, you know, poking us that we have to do this. So really, thank you so much, Prosperity, for being there with us all the time. And all the support is available to you. So thank you so much, everyone, for asking very good questions. Keep putting the mails on your social media so that we can attract more people and spread a wonderful word. And so that's all I can say, and help each other to grow wherever we are. So even if we go a little bit, I think it makes a huge difference to us and to our families. So thank you so much, and see you this Friday. So we'll have a webinar from our coaches, which will get the mail as well. Good night. Stay safe.
Okay.
Love you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good night. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.